If you can tell me there's a way to biohack your body and it eliminates all infections from your body, it eliminates all toxins from your body, it increases your proper detoxification pathways, it changes all of your genetics, it helps you with your adrenals, let me know when a biohack takes care of all of that. Because it's not going to. All right, everybody, welcome to another episode of the Doc Jock Show. Today, we're going to push the envelope again, because why not? It's my show. I can kind of do what I want on this within reason. And today, we're going to talk about why I hate biohacking. And you might be like, well, Jacques, in your intro, you said, well, wait, you're going to teach us how to biohack your health. And I'll get there. And this is my intro into that. But what I've been finding is a lot of people just use these biohacks to continue to live the same toxic lifestyle that made them sick to begin with. So why don't we just dive right in here today and say why I don't like them? And that's pretty much the reason. When people use these biohacks, they think that all they have to do is jump in a cryo tank real quick and then they can get out and they can go eat McDonald's or they can go eat Burger King, etc. Now, the people who are biohacking aren't typically those people. So you might be like, well, I'm not that person. I eat organic, I eat clean, I'm good to go, but my knees hurt or my shoulder hurts, or I feel like I have some digestive issues, but when I do this particular therapy, again, not just talking about the ice baths or the polar plunges or anything, but when I do this particular therapy, I feel good. And so then my follow-up question for that is, well, you feel good until when? Until you don't feel good anymore. So a lot of these biohacks are used to reduce inflammation in the body. It's pretty much what it is. If we don't find that root cause for why that inflammation crept up to begin with, it's not biohacking your body. You're holistically band-aiding your body because your body's going to continue to fall apart. And that's one of the things that sets me apart from other functional medicine practitioners, from other naturopathic doctors, from other chiropractors, whoever you go to, acupuncturists. Well, they're a little bit more in line with what I do. But the thing is, we can't just whack-a-mole symptoms, or we can't just keep removing batteries out of your fire alarm. And so these biohackers are like, well, listen, I'm not on any medications. I'm like, great. And then I see your intake form and I see 15 different supplements that you're on. I'm like, why are you taking this? And they're like, well, this one helps me with memory. This one helps me with weight loss. This one helps me remain in ketosis. This one helps me with digestion. And I'm like, well, why is your conscious mind, why is your humanness trying to interfere with your body's natural processes? And I guess there might be a better way for me to word this, but if you stop taking all of those supplements, what's going to happen to your body? It's going to resume being inflamed. It's going to resume the same amount of brain fog, if not more. It's going to cause you to become inflamed. It's going to cause you to gain weight. It's going to cause you to have hormonal imbalances. So when we're talking about this biohacking is great to be used in conjunction with causal treatment. So say, for example, we've got mold toxicity. Mold is just running rampant in your body. A really well-known, well-researched, well-documented, quote-unquote, biohack is hitting the infrared sauna. It's a phenomenal thing to do, right? But if you're still living in that environment that has mold in it, then you're going to be detoxing mold. You go home, your pores are wide open, and then you're going to be retoxing that mold back into your body. What about Epsom salt baths, right? What if you're taking an Epsom salt bath and the reason that you're doing it is because you have a horrible relationship with your spouse? You're treating a symptom. I need to bring my cortisol down. Great. You're going to need to stay in that bathtub for the rest of your life because your relationship sucks. So when it comes to biohacking, we have to understand, like, listen, these things are great. The research is there. I mean, there's a lot of really cool things that you're able to do with your body. But if we don't first understand, why is my body responding the way that it is? What caused me to shift away from my normal healthy homeostasis? What is homeostasis? Homeostasis is that happy, healthy baseline, Okay. What's your current level of health? Without elation or depression, without excitement or depression, what is your current state of health? Where are you functioning at? Okay. That's your baseline. And then you have other things that are going to shove you either in a hyperactive state or a hypoactive state, or too much or too little. And different disease states can do different things. Diet can do different things. Red meat can have an impact on your sympathetic nervous system, and it can cause your adrenals to creep up and work harder. Plant-based foods can cause your adrenals to calm down a little bit more. So there's ways you could therapeutically treat your adrenals just from food. Okay, obviously reducing sugar and carbs and all that stuff and getting a good balanced protein in there and good fats. But the thing is with these biohacks, the reason I hate them is because nobody really understands the true concept behind it. You'll see Joe Rogan jump in a cryo bath. And I know Joe Rogan is probably doing a lot of other stuff behind the scene, but what is he promoting? He's promoting gimmicks. What are half the other influencers that are on social media doing? They're promoting biohacks. And again, they're great, but the results don't last. And so two things can happen. One, you become addicted to that therapy and you continue to, again, live that toxic lifestyle, still stay in that toxic relationship and still have horrible habits. You don't sleep well at night. So you do something during a day to calm yourself down, or you go into a float tank and try to meditate in a float tank. But that's really the only time you get to relax because you're away from your spouse or you're away from your kids, right? And so when we're just constantly promoting the new thing, whether it's red light therapy or cryotherapy or sauna, or you do this tapping or you do this, that, the other thing, well, guys, why does your body require it to begin with? Break it down super simplistically put. Why is your body in a state of dis-ease or dysfunction? Why? Why is it? Again, this is why I'm so much different. I will not stop until I find that underlying cause. And I challenge you, if you're doing these things, if you're doing these therapies just to keep things at bay, fantastic. But also, know that there is a cause, right? If I have a splinter in my foot and it freaking hurts, but I go and I take ice and I numb my foot, or I jump in an ice bath and I numb my foot, I won't feel that splinter. I won't feel it until inflammation rises again. I get that red color to the bottom of my foot, okay? And what's going to happen? Pain is going to return because the splinter was never removed. Now, in the biohacker's mind, well, guess what? I need to just continue to keep treating that, keep icing it, keep icing it, keep icing it, keep icing it. But the splinter is still under the surface. And just because you can't feel the pain does not mean that the dis-ease is gone. It doesn't mean that. And in fact, inflammation, acute inflammation, is positive to your body. It's a good thing. So if you go for a run or you do a hard-ass workout and you're like, whew, I am exhausted from that, jump in the ice bath, you just stopped your healing process. You stopped it. You stopped it dead in its tracks. Why? Because you iced it. You need increased blood flow to go to those areas, right? And then you'd be like, well, what if I do cold, hot, cold, hot, cold, hot, end on cold? What's that going to do? Now, it can help you, okay? It can help you short term in that interim, yes. But again, as my good friend Kenzie said, so Kenzie, if you're listening to this, this one's for you. Are you playing God with your body? You know, this is a question that people need to ask themselves. Are you playing God with your body? We just did some videos. We did a video shoot this morning and she brought that up as like something that would be good for me to talk about. If we're trying to pretend that we as man and man spread, broad spread, woman, whatever, if we as our humanity are trying to control every single aspect of our body, that's trying to, that the ego, that egoic center is trying to come out and say, body, you're stupid. Let me take care of this from here. And you're like, oh, I know you're screaming at me. I know I've got brain fog right now, but I'm going to take a supplement for that. I'm not going to change the fact that I'm pounding down carbs and I don't have sleep and I'm stressed out of my mind. I'm going to use something to biohack that or jump over that hurdle. Okay. Yeah, that's a good example. Jump over that hurdle and pretend that it's just a thing in the past. Well, guess what? If you're on a track and you come back around again, guess what you're going to come across? That same hurdle. What are you going to do? You're going to take that same supplement again, jump over the hurdle and keep going until that hurdle keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And eventually that supplement doesn't work anymore. So when I said there's two things that can happen, you can either continue to to self-medicate yourself with these holistic biohacking approaches, or you'll have somebody who's like, listen, I'm done with westernized medicine. God bless you for doing that. I'm done with westernized medicine. I want to do things natural. And so-and-so said, I just need to do this and I'll be A-okay. And they do it. And then the same thing happens. They come around, boom, they smacked into that hurdle. And they're like, well, I still, my ankle still hurts. And my gut is still kind of feels like it's rotted. And well, I'm just going to take some digestive enzymes because that could be considered a biohack, right? I'm just going to take some digestive enzymes and my digestive tract will be super peachy keen. But unbeknownst to you, because you didn't test it and because Joe Schmo with no degree over here told you to do it, you've got an H. pylori infection. And you're like, well, great. I don't feel the H. pylori infection, but what's it doing? H. pylori is found in 80% of stomach ulcer cases. You're not going to be properly absorbing your protein. You're going to have an increased amount of food sensitivities. You're going to have bloating. You're going to have anxiety. You're going to have brain fog. You can have Hashimoto's. You can have, again, cancers. You can have so many things that can happen in the body. But you're never taught. You're never taught, unless you do this on your own, you're not taught what symptoms to look for and what dis-ease is in the body. I'm not saying disease. I'm saying dis-ease, a state of dis-ease where your body's not happy. It's not in harmony. It's like having a guitar that's out of tune and you strum it and you're like, ah, that sounded terrible. That didn't sound like a guitar. Well, guess what? When you strum your chords and they're not in tune, you're not in harmony, which means you're not in alignment with your divinity. Divinity is how we heal. The closer we get to our God-given divinity, the easier it is for our bodies to heal. It's also easier to not get sucked into the latest craze of something to be worried about, whether it's a disease, a virus, a bacteria, a parasite, whatever it is. We know that if our bodies come in contact with it, our innate intelligence, what we were born with, this power within us, is going to then overcome that particular infection. An example, I just did another training with this with one of my mentors, Dr. Kalish. Super brilliant dude. If you don't know him, follow him. The guy is a wealth of knowledge. He's an amazing human being. And he brought up the fact that they did an inhumane study, well, considered now inhumane study. They gave people in jail, in prison, parasite drink. So they had Giardia in it. Okay. And they had two categories of people. They tested their secretory IgA or their immune system markers. And they had a category that was low, so low secretory IgA or low immune system function. And then they had one with normal or high secretory IgA function. And they gave the parasites to these people. The people with the high secretory IgA or normal secretory IgA, normal immune response, had symptoms, but it lasted maybe like 12 hours, a day or two, and parasite was gone. No long-lasting impact. It was just some discomfort. Again, normal innate intelligence crap. It happened. You felt horrible. Why? It's poison in your body and your body has to get rid of it. If it's going to be vomiting or diarrhea, it has to get it out. Do not treat it. Do not stop it. Allow your innate intelligence to do what it's supposed to. Now, I'm not saying, hey, let yourself have diarrhea until you pass out from dehydration. Get some IVs, get some fluid. You can do some patch repair if you choose, but don't stop that innate intelligence and that innate process from occurring. Otherwise, you're either going to have a longer duration of symptoms or it's going to come back again. And so when we had the people with the lower secretory IgA, they had a more intense bout of it. They had a worse case. It lasted longer and the recovery time took far longer, right? Because their innate intelligence, their innate immune system was weak. So in that instance, if I'm like, hey, jump in a cryo bath, okay? Or hey, go take some Pepto or go take just a probiotic. Right? I'm just covering my face. If you're listening to me, I'm literally covering my face and I'm throwing stuff at a wall right now. If you're watching me, you saw what I just did, but you're shooting in the dark. You're throwing spaghetti at a wall. You're blindly trying to assess with your pea brain in here, your primal brain saying, I know better. I'm going to do this. No, let your body do its dang thing. So when we're talking, we're bringing it back to this biohacking stuff. We're trying to tell our bodies, not trying, we are innately, our conscious mind is telling our subconscious mind, listen, you screwed up, I'll take it from here. Which then rewires your subconscious mind to say, I'm broke, I am in a state of dis-ease. Now I have disease and now I'm not good and now I can't function on my own. So anytime this happens, I need this medication. I need this, I need this, I need this, I need this because I'm inferior. And when does that cycle ever stop? It doesn't. And it doesn't matter if it's a medication or if it's a holistic band-aid, if it's a supplement, okay? I can't stress this enough. And I've done multiple podcasts on this. You can tell how fired up I am. I can't stand it when people are like, just take this. You have constipation, just take this. You have a thyroid condition, you just need this. You have this going on, just take this. Chronic fatigue, take this. Like, what the hell are you? What are you doing? Because you're luring people with a sense of promise, this false promise that this is going to do the trick. And no two people have the same condition for the same reason. You know how many times I've treated a thyroid condition to have nothing to do with the thyroid at all? So you're saying, oh, go take some selenium or go eat some seaweed or some kelp. That's going to help your thyroid. What if you have H. pylori? What if your gut's inflamed and you can't convert T4 to T3 peripherally? That kelp isn't going to help you freaking do it. It might make your numbers look okay-ish, or more often than not, you won't get retested, so you don't really know. And you're like, well, this didn't freaking work. So you go away from the holistic side. You go back to medication. I need Synthroid because that kelp didn't work. I need to go see my GI specialist because that probiotic didn't work. Or I need to go back on my Miralax because this didn't work. Do you see what's happening here? So when we're talking about biohacking, we're not just talking about like the red light therapy. We're not just talking about the sauna, the cryo, the other things, and the tapping and all of this stuff. It's all, that stuff is all amazing to use properly. Properly. Use it in conjunction with causal treatment. What does that mean? Okay, again, if we've got mold toxicity, you better find out where that mold's coming from. Are you eating moldy foods? Are you eating peanuts? Are you eating pistachios? Are you drinking normal coffee? Okay, these are just some typical things that have mold in them. Are you doing that? Are you eating dried vine fruit? Are you drinking wine? It's possible you're going to be getting mold in. What if your house is poisoning you every single day, all day, every day? No amount of biohacking is going to allow your body to overcome the level of toxic burden inside you. Okay, so what do? Find the cause, find the threat. Right? If it's your house, find out where the mold is, get the mold treated or move out of the house, start fresh. Okay. Step one, find the cause. Step two, what's happening in the body? How can I best help? How can I best work with the body? What did I just say? How do I work with the body once I know what exactly is wrong? Work with the body once you know exactly what is wrong. You have no idea how many patients I meet with where I just want to just lunge through the phone and flip through their health records and call every single one of their doctors. Be like, how dare you? How dare you lie to this patient? How dare you say there's nothing wrong with them? How dare you say there's nothing wrong with the thyroid? How dare you say it's impossible to have mold in your body because mold, if you had mold in your body, you'd be dead. These are all things that I have heard from patients just in the last 2 weeks. This amount of absurdity needs to change. My message has always been, please, please be your own health advocate. And you need a doctor who understands that you want to be empowered to take over your health. And these are the clients that I'm working with, people who want to be better, whether it's they do have a disease state right now where they're in a state of dis-ease, or exceptional people who are like, hey, I just want to see if I could be better because I'm doing pretty darn good now. And as a society, we have this tendency to be too good to be great. So we're just, wow, we're good. No, I don't want to rock the boat. I'm good. I'm good. Nah, I'm good. Ah, no, I don't like change. Yeah, growth, not fun. I don't like it. I'm good. I'm good right here. Good does not allow you to be great. Good leads you to ending up being a statistic like all of the Americans that are out there. Increased risk of heart disease, increased risk of cancer, increased risk of diabetes. Okay, these are all things that could be helped through what we do. I joked with one of my buddies, Johnny L. Sasser, about this. I'm like, I feel like I'm in the Minority Report. And he said, I should do a series on that. Maybe I should. And you heard it here first. So if somebody steals this idea, I'm coming for you. But really, like, I'm predicting the future when people come to me. I'm predicting the future because I know. Either I've seen it happen in a patient And they come to me when everything falls apart and I don't know what else to do. Everything has failed me. Muscle testing has failed me. Bioscanning has failed me. Acupuncture has failed me. This has failed me. I mean, there's new ologists that I'm hearing about. I'm like, what the hell do they do? Failing them. And then we get concrete evidence. Oh, okay. We've got 5 infections here. We've got a bunch of parasites that your scans didn't catch. Or we've got H. pylori that you never picked up on. Or you've got this, or you've got that, or you've got this, or you've got mold. There's so many things. And for me, I'm like, whew, I'm excited. Because I see potential in every single person that I work with. And I work with people of all walks of life. But I love when people are like, listen, this quality of life that I'm living right now is not enough. And I'll work with 20-year-olds that can't go to the bathroom. I'll see 20-year-olds that can't go to the bathroom. Then I'll see 20-year-olds that are going to the bathroom and they can't leave the house because they are going to the bathroom. I had a patient years back that was bleeding. She'd go off to school and she would have bloody mucousy stool, ulcerative colitis type symptoms. And I'm like, well, we gotta change this. We gotta change your habits. And it's not about, I just want to stop pooping myself. It's like, listen, what is that gonna look like 5, 10, 15 years down the line? That means no more friends. Your relationship is gonna be destroyed because you can't do anything. You can't go anywhere. You're going to be on medications. Your hormones are going to be tanked because your body's going to be throwing your cholesterol to try to repair your gut. Yeah, again, brain function gone, thyroid function's gone. Muscle atrophy is going to take place because you're not breaking down proteins properly and you'll literally die within. You'll die from within. So if somebody came up to those people again and were just like, all you need is this. All you need is to do this thing and just do some red light therapy over here and you just need to do this. But they never took away the work that you have to put into it to get better. They're always going to go back. Always. Or they're always going to be dependent on this treatment of symptoms. But remember, guys, biohacking by itself is a holistic band-aid. If you can provide proof that some sort of biohacking that maybe I'm unaware of, and I'm open for this, I'm open for conversation for this, but if you can tell me there's a way to biohack your body and it eliminates all infections from your body, it eliminates all toxins from your body. It increases your proper detoxification pathways. It changes all of your genetics. It helps you with your adrenals. Let me know. And then also let me know how that also improves your relationships and allows you to learn how to communicate with your spouse. Let me know how that also changes your pantry, how you shop, and how you breathe, how you raise your kids, how your kids impact you, how you exercise. Let me know when a biohack takes care of all of that, because it's not going to. A biohack is just like a medication. Dr. Charlie Majors talked about this. Medications are just a permission slip to continue to still or keep living that lifestyle that made you sick to begin with. Okay? And I remember, like, he's passed. It's been years since he's passed, but that's something that has always stuck with me when I heard him speak. He's a really well-respected chiropractor. And he always talked about that. Biohacking or holistic biohacking or holistic medications, because that's basically how people are treating this allopathic approach, will always fail you 100% of the time. So the other thing that becomes very important to talk about is another topic that has come up. I'm going to kind of blend this in with the biohacking side of things. But when it comes to a symptom taking place in the body, right? Again, we'll go for thyroid because I've been having a lot of thyroid cases lately. So thyroid. Thyroid is usually a response organ or a response gland. And when I say response, it responds to our environment, both externally, so outside of us, and then internally or inside of us. So if your thyroid starts to get in a state of dis-ease, and I just look at your thyroid, I'm going to miss the boat 100% of the time. I'm not going to get you results. I'm not going to get you long-lasting results. No doctor will. None. And this is the problem with endocrinologists too. Is like, hey, I got a thyroid problem. Well, I'll test your thyroid. First off, they do a completely inaccurate test of the thyroid and they leave it there. That's it. Medication. And then people will come to me like, hey, I got diagnosed with Hashimoto's. I'm like, did they test your antibodies? No, they grabbed my thyroid or my TSH was off. So they said I had Graves or I had Hashimoto. Said medication was all I could do for it. Like, how's that medication going to help you with your autoimmune condition? How's it going to stop the antibody production? It's not going to. Eventually, you're going to get to the point where your thyroid gets so bad that what's going to happen? They're going to kill it or they're going to remove it. They'll give you a poison pill that you can't touch anybody for multiple days. And I'm not joking. This is how they do it. It's radioactive iodine. They'll put it in your body. You can't touch your spouse for days because you're radioactive. Oh, and it just hits your thyroid gland. No, everything is intertwined. This is kind of what I'm getting at. Your thyroid is going to be in response to stress. Did you just work out? Have you been spending too long in a calorie deficit? Not enough calories. And again, is your gut inflamed? Do you have infections over here? Do you have mold toxicity? Are you eating poor food? Are you eating gluten all the time? Are you eating sugar nonstop all day, every day? Do you even exercise? You know, like all of these things that are going to intertwine, but no organ, no cell, no tissue functions without communicating to others. So as your thyroid goes down, right? It goes up. You get a hyperthyroid. What's a symptom of hyperthyroid? Racing heart, anxiety. Huh. Does the thyroid gland, does that increase those particular hormones? No. But the response from the thyroid then communicates with your heart and heart flutters. Okay. Or anxiety. Oh, goes to the brain. Nothing's left. Nothing's left intact. What about your heart? Okay. You have high cholesterol. I can't get it up anymore. I have erectile dysfunction. Well, is it the problem downstairs or is it the problem upstairs? Oh, put a thought behind a thought. Upstairs, if you've got plaquing in your arterial walls, okay, if you got plaquing in those areas, your blood flow is going to be decreased. You're also going to have more viscous blood or thicker blood. So your blood, your heart is going to have to pump harder and harder and harder to get the blood to flow to the areas that you would like it to. What about cortisol? Stressed all day, every day. Your HPA axis, I mean, I feel like there's nothing that your HPA axis leaves alone. It destroys everything if you're not careful, because it puts you in that state of fight or flight constantly. And if you don't know how to get off that hamster wheel, you don't know how to change your perception of events around you, as well as rebound quickly, it will completely consume your life. And then again, your conscious mind radios back to your subconscious mind and you keep this wheel going all day, every day, nonstop. So we'll talk about HPA axis, right? So if you're stressed all the time, people will ask me, what do you do to help to relax your sympathetic nervous system? Well, old brain me says, go get adjusted, get your atlas adjusted, okay? Top neck bone, get that sucker adjusted. You'll take tension off of there. You're good to go, right? Could be a cause. Head forward posture would technically be the cause. It could rotate that atlas around and therefore you have pressure on those nerves and therefore you have said symptom, right? Because it puts dorsal tension on the spinal cord. Huge cause, especially in society today. But what if you're constantly eating inflammatory food and all of a sudden your atlas keeps kicking out because you're inflamed and keeps going boop and it keeps going boop? Or what if you're playing football and boop, smacking your head all the time, right? So adjustments can help. Absolutely. That was like, again, old school brain to me is like, just get adjusted. You'll be great. It will absolutely help. But technically, it's kind of like a biohack for the body. It allows your body to try to function properly, but it gives you kind of like that. Like if you're treading water and you go underwater for a couple minutes or not a couple, hopefully not a couple minutes, go underwater for 30 seconds and you come up and you're like, oh my gosh, that was good. And then all of a sudden, you go back down again because the rocks come, they're tied to your ankles. And you're like, oh my God, what's those rocks? What's more stress? It's more stress from your environment. So then what's another thing that you could do? You can absolutely do sound bowl healing. Okay, sound healing. You can do breath work techniques. Let's go with sound bowl, right? Sound bowls are amazing. My wife does an amazing job and you'll see a lot more from her, trust me. But when it comes, and she knows this, when it comes to sound healing, right, it can help to change your vibrational frequency of the body to calm your body down. But then you leave that safe space. If you have an abusive husband, an abusive kids, an abusive wife, if you're in a financial crisis, okay, if you almost get hit on the way home or if you start watching news again, how long did that sound healing last for you? Just the duration of the session. So people are like, how often should I do sound healing? I'm like, do it as much as you can, because it does. It helps. It if you've never experienced it, trust me, reach out. And my wife is freaking advanced with this stuff. She's really good with she's brilliant with all this musical stuff. She's so gifted in this way. But like, she does it where it just hijacks your body. You have no choice but to be calm when the bulls start going. It's amazing. And I know a couple other practitioners, Regina and Sammy, like, you guys are all amazing with the sound healing. It's unbelievable. But if we don't change that cause, sound healing can just be a biohack. What about breath work, right? Breath work, you can find your inner demons and you will come face to face with inner demons. The word that people will use is, you need time to integrate what you found or how to apply what you found back into your life. If you don't do that, you just increased a boatload of sympathetic stress. So can sound healing and can breath work help to calm your sympathetic nervous system? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Just breath by itself, doing box breathing, can calm you down. It can bring you back from the ledge. But if all of the people are still pushing you back out onto that ledge again, you're going to need to do box breathing all day, every day. Another form of biohacking. Do you see what I'm getting at here? There's so many things that play into this. Perception is key. I've talked about this many times on the podcast, but say there's you put me on a football field. It's the example I use all the time. I will light up like a Christmas tree. I get so flipping excited. Even though the last times I've played collegiate or competitive football, I tore my medial meniscus. I had a significant injury that led to surgery. I still perceive football as highly enjoyable. Or I play softball. Not very competitive softball, but I'll play softball and I'll come back with a pulled quad. And I still try to show up next week. Why? Because I love it. It's fun. It's enjoyable. My perception of it is, I leave that event, yes, there's a little damage. I'm going to have to rehab myself a little bit afterwards, but I get a sense of enjoyment from it. But you put somebody else in that same position that has never played football or never played softball before in their life, they're going to have a completely different reaction. They're going to be sweaty. Their sympathetic nervous system is going to ramp up in a negative way versus me, where I get adrenaline. I'm like, woo, let's go. Let's go. I can't wait. Come on, get this team off the field so I can step on the field. Like, let's go. Give me a bat. Let's do this. Right? So when it comes to biohacking, there is nothing truly, you know, the real underlying message of this is, biohacking is amazing, but it is not meant to be used by itself. Okay, it's not. And I think that a lot of biohackers are starting to realize this. You know, one of the OGs, right? One of the OGs is Dave Asprey. He has this whole clinic, I think it's in California, but he has this biohacking clinic, right? Which is great. Biohack and retune your body. Good, good, good. But then if you go back to that moldy environment, or you go back to that work stress, kid stress, relationship stress, financial stress, what happens? You're going to have to sign up again to go biohack your body, right? Or Ben Greenfield. He is super well known. A lot of my patients know Ben Greenfield. I think that man is brilliant. However, biohacking used by itself means nothing. Greenfield, I think, is also starting to come along with this. It's been a while since I've read his books, but I know that he's starting to broaden his horizon. He actually spoke for the supplement company that I use with Designs for Health, which is pretty cool. But we have to understand why our body did what it did. Otherwise, history will repeat itself. And I'm not talking about United States history, because we're there on that. I'm talking about health history. If you've been pounding down gluten, but nobody ever told you why gluten was bad, and you use this holistic band-aid, you're like, oh, now I can still eat gluten. But it caused your problem. Yeah. But I can do a cryo bath, or I can go sit in some Epsom salt. Okay, let me know how that works out for you. And all of a sudden, 10 years later, like, I don't know why I have all these health conditions. I do my cryo baths, right? Because that's what's going to happen. Like, the biohacking, there's stuff that's been around for a while, the saunas and things like that. Totally cool. And a lot of the biohacking was overseas, Sweden, like those types of people would do their polar plunges and stuff. But they don't have the same lifestyle as us. They eat cleaner. I don't even think they have the word organic over there, because all of their food is organic. It's naturally raised. Their stress is lower. You know, I was thinking about this on my car ride home from the gym here today. I'm like, You know, at what point, and this is going to sound bad, and I'm not, again, not anti-American, whatever, not patriotic. I'm just saying, like, at what point do we have a little bit of jealousy for these third world countries? Because they don't have these people, not all, some of them do, but like if you just had a third world country or just like a little island and you didn't have this ruling hand that's poisoning your food, spraying pesticide, herbicide on your food, adding chemicals to your food, and you're just able to say, hey, there's a pig, I'm going to go grab it, slaughter it, and make some dinner. And you go ahead and pick some fruit off the trees or some berries, and we're going to put together a really nice, delicious meal. Right? That's, and again, don't quote through a road. I'm saying in a perfect world, like without government involvement, like that would be a pretty phenomenal, pretty luring thing. And we're like, yay, USA is number one just because we say it is. And it's not. It's not number one. We're falling apart from the inside out. We can't even have a leader that knows how to freaking read a teleprompter. Anyways, I highly digress from that. But what I'm saying is, and that's a stress right there too, right? So if I meditate, that's another one. Okay, meditation is phenomenal. All of these things, phenomenal. But if I meditate first thing in the morning, okay, all I'm doing, and with these biohackings, all I'm doing is bringing myself or trying to bring myself from that current state back to homeostasis, back to my normal baseline, okay? And then repetitive use of the biohacking can theoretically reset your baseline. If you're stressed, it can make your threshold seem a lot higher to hit, or your bucket is a lot more empty, so you can handle a lot more stress. Totally get it. However, if I meditate first thing in the morning, I'm like, cool, I did meditation, I did my gratitude, I did this, I did my exercise, I'm good to go. What's on the news? Death and despair. Or what's on Instagram? Oh, so-and-so is fit, I need to work harder. This motivational speaker says I'm worthless. This one says I'm not making enough money. This one says I have to have 7 streams of income. This one says it, this one says this. What did you just do? You just brought yourself away from what you just did. It's true. It's 100% true. And if you want another way to reset that baseline for stress, fix your gut. Research shows that if your gut is inflamed, you will make mountains out of molehills. You will have an exacerbated reaction to stress. Don't believe me? Get the stomach bug, okay? And then deal with confrontation. See how short you are in confrontation, okay? I had food poisoning a couple days ago. Yay, that was enjoyable. I was really short. Guess who else was? My son. Super short. I still have no idea what the hell I ate, but 12 hours of like bubble guts and then done. There it was. What? Am I mad at my body? No, my innate intelligence got the toxins out of my body exactly the way that it was supposed to. Did I eat? Nope. I fasted, right? Because fasting in those situations can help. Because if you just put food on top of toxins, then it's more work for your body to get the crap out, literally and figuratively. Hopefully you don't crap out your mouth. Otherwise, that's a South Park episode. But we need to understand the use of biohacking. So do I hate biohacking? Yes. Do I love biohacking? Yes. When used properly. Okay. So next time you think about this biohacking thing that you want to implement into practice, remember, before implementation, be sure to find out why your body is in the state that it currently is. Otherwise, you will always be doomed to repeat the same cycle. Which then gets into the mindset side of things where you're like, every time, or this meditation doesn't work for me, or this cryo doesn't work for me, or the sauna doesn't work for me, or the supplement doesn't work for me. And I'm over here like, well, you never addressed the cause. So yeah, right? It's like, hey, my bicycle never works, or it always pulls to the left-hand side. My car is doing it. It's pulling to the right-hand side right now. I'm getting alignment on Monday. And if I'm just like, well, you know, I'm just going to steer a little bit harder to the left and I'm just going to pretend that's good. What's going to happen? The rest of my car is going to deteriorate. It's going to have to try to shift from that dis-ease. It's going to bring my baseline down to a worse state and I'm just going to stay there. So make sure you address the cause. I cannot stress that enough. And this message is going out for anybody who is currently biohacking, anybody who is currently just supplementally causing your body to have less dis-ease in your body. But supplements are just designed to supplement your current state of health and your current lifestyle. I do not want any of my patients to be on supplements for the rest of their life. I don't want that. Yeah, I remember Dave Asprey says he takes like, I think it's like 50 pills a day. I'm like, what are you doing, bro? Like, why are you doing that? What is your current state of health like? And no offense, Dave, and this was years ago that he said this. So maybe his philosophy has changed, just like it has on different fasting techniques and things. But we need to understand the why, and we have to stop covering up. We have to, because in today's society, we always want the Amazon Prime fix. We want things to be gone immediately. We feel uncomfortable. Ugh, as a society, we're not used to feeling discomfort. Right now, I think it's 78 degrees in my house. I don't know. I think maybe my thermostat's broken, but I'm very comfortable right now, 78 degrees in a long sleeve shirt. People are not used to discomfort. Or if I go outside, I think it's 111, 113, according to that death device over there. So 111 degrees outside. If I go outside, I'm going to have a state of discomfort and I'm going to sweat. We're not told that sweat is a bad thing, right? But it is a symptom. It's a symptom of disease or dis-ease in the body. Our body's uncomfortable. What's it do? It sweats. Why? So if a wind goes by, it cools off our body easier than if we didn't have sweat. Pretty brilliant. And on top of it, you're detoxing while it's happening. It's a positive stress, right? Positive. So we need to get comfortable being uncomfortable, because that's where the growth takes place. That's where the learning takes place. That's where you, and a lot of my patients are, you become smarter than your doctor. Okay. Now I promise you, you'll never be smarter than me. Why? Because I'm never going to stop learning. I've been at this for many, many years, and I am so dang hungry to continue to learn more and more and more. And you know, the funny thing, I know the modern stuff like it's the back of my hand. You know what I'm going back and doing? I'm not like, hey, what's the latest research say? I say, what were we doing prior to medications? Prior to J.D. Rockefeller getting in there and screwing up this whole holistic approach, the Easternized approach got taken advantage of and got turned into synthetic chemicals, which is what we have today. Modern medicine, modern poison. What were we doing before that? What herbs were we using, right? What, again, I'm learning a little bit about acupuncture too. What are we talking about, like the dampening and the dryness and these, the cheese? What are we doing with that? What have people been doing for many years? What have different cultures been doing without these quote unquote modern advancements? Just because it's a modern advancement does not mean it's better. Okay, it doesn't. So sometimes we have to rewind the hands of time. And this is why, again, you'll never know more than me. It's impossible, because I'm always going to consume more and more and more. And I do this every day. And I have the clinical practice as well. And I train other doctors. So then I get to see the patients that I work with, but then I also get to work with my doctor's patients, because I'm helping make an impact in their life. So the amount of cases that come across his desk on a weekly basis, it keeps growing and growing and growing. And I get to see more causal relationships between this, that, and the other thing. What infection causes this? What disease states causes that? What diet's good for this? What about this fertility case? What about this mold case? Because everyone is a little bit more unique than the next person. No two people are the same. Even if they have the same mold composition of the body, do you have MPHFR? Do you have COMT? Do you have HLA-DR? Right? These are all things that are like, okay, these genetic SNPs people might not know about. But you have to know yourself inside and out. You have to have a doctor who's willing to take the time to teach you. That's the end of this, okay? Because with my protocols, super easy. For me, super easy. I already know. I spend the day before and sometimes 2-3 days before reading over your tests, going through the previous notes and getting everything set to go. But do you know where I've been going recently? Like, all right, how have you been doing? Let's do a check-in, see how the symptoms are. Oh, here's your score. You drop down. That's great. You improve by 20 points, 30 points, 50 points, whatever. What else is new and unusual in your life? And I'm starting to become a counselor with different types of things where, again, supplements can help what I see on a test, but you have a cortisol spike at 5 p.m. What are you doing at 5 o'clock? Ooh, your spouse comes home. Why does your cortisol shoot through the roof? Ooh, bad relationship, poor communication. Oh, your kids come home from activities at this time or first thing in the morning through the roof. Why? Well, I'm getting food on the table. I have to take care of this. I have to do this. I get my workout in. I have 5 cups of coffee. I'm like, whoa, okay. Supplements are cool, but this lifestyle here is going to make you stay on those supplements for a prolonged period of time, right? What if I'm treating H. pylori? Can't have gluten, can't have dairy, can't have sugars. You have to be a very strict diet. Don't have spicy food, don't have bubbly stuff, right? Get the hell away from mold. Reduce your stress. But if you're still stressed out of your mind, your job sucks, your relationship sucks, and you're guzzling down mold from your air ducts, whether it's in your house or in your building, in your work building, what's going to happen? H. pylori is going to continue to stay around, where I'm just going to have to continue treating and treating and treating and treating and treating until you fix that underlying cause for why your body's in the current state of health that it is. This is where the true healing happens. This is where doctors are unwilling to go. Why? One, it's freaking hard to dig deep. It's hard for you as the doctor, but it's hard for you as a patient as well to really think about this. You know, are these emotions mine? Talking as a patient, are these emotions mine? Is my belief system set on what I believe, or is it what was passed down from me from my grandparents or my parents? You start to become your own person, right? And again, if I'm just like, all you need to do is take the CBD and you'll be great. You'll sleep really great. CBD, fantastic for you. Don't get me wrong. Anti-cancer properties, phenomenal for sleep. But if you don't address the problem, you're going to be on CBD for the rest of your life, right? I don't have an appetite. I smoke weed or I do cannabis. I eat edibles and I get my appetite back. Cool. Why don't you have an appetite to begin with? Do you have no stomach acid? Achlorhydria? Do you have a little bit? Hypochlorhydria? Or do you have H. pylori? I don't know. What is it? What's going on? Find that root cause. So I stress, I urge, think about it. The next time you jump to biohacking, find out why. Find out why your body is responding the way that it is. And when patients are on my programs and protocols, I have some patients down in the Texas area, I won't get specifics, but they have a phenomenal holistic biohacking clinic nearby. And we're like, okay, you've got this in your body. Cool. Yeah, go do infrared therapy there. We're working on the rest of the stuff in the body. You already changed your environment. Like, let's get you healing. Let's go. We can use it to help to accelerate certain processes that we're working on. But we can't use it as a solo treatment. Otherwise, we'll never get long-lasting results, which is what I promise for my patients. Long-lasting results. As long as you do what you're supposed to, and you change your lifestyle, you change your habits, and you change your diet, and you change all the things that made you sick to begin with, you will get results every single time. You have to get results changing these things because all of this plays into your current state of health, your current state of life, and how you show up. How you show up as a parent, how you show up as a spouse, how you show up as a leader, how you show up at church, how you show up with your kids, how you show up with your parents, how you show up in general. And the better we can be and the cleaner we can be, the more in harmony we'll be, the more with our divinity we'll be, the more powerful we'll be, so that way we can overcome anything that we come across in our daily routine. And I think I'm going to end with that. So thank you. If you follow along this entire time, I spoke really fast today. I was very passionate today, but I wanted to get this information out there. Again, quick synopsis. It's not that biohacking is terrible for you. It just needs to be used properly. So that being said, love you all. Thanks for tuning in and be sure to share this one because I can almost guarantee you, you know somebody who's tried some biohacking and this can definitely help that person out. So thank you all.